Macmillan Audio presents The Masque of the Red Death by Cory Doctorow. Read for you by Stefan Rudnicki. Before the event, Martin Mars spent a lot of time trying to game it out. Would the collapse be sudden, catching him off guard and unprepared, having to fight his way to his fortress as he escaped from Paradise Valley and into the desert hills? Or would there be some kind of sign? A steady uptick in civil disorder and failures from the official powers that counted down to the day, giving him a chance to plan an orderly withdrawal to Fort Doom. This was important. If Martin spooked and ran for Fort Doom too early, he'd have to slink back to the city and his job after however many days he'd spent bunkered up. Not only would it be humiliating, but it would cost him credibility with the 30... the people he'd invited to survive the apocalypse with him. Once Fort Doom was buttoned up for the duration, he'd need to be a credible leader or he could lose control. Who the fuck knew what would happen next? He had visions of some distant descendant cracking the big doors and finding their mummified corpses sprawled in the postures they'd crumpled into when the ravening mob had turned on itself. Every time he sounded the alarm and brought the 30 out, he increased the chance that one or more of them would leak the existence of Fort Doom. They were all under strict pledges of secrecy. But when shit's going down, someone's gonna leak to that cute girl they were trying to get with and or leave a trail that some curious rando would follow. There would come a day when the 30 would have to defend what was theirs from the people who'd lacked the foresight to build their own fortresses. But Martin's preference was for that day to be a long way off, after they'd had a chance to cohere into the mutual survival unit they'd need to be to wait out the event. So, there were many reasons not to send up a flare and summon everyone to the fort prematurely. But what about the costs of waiting too long? Paradise Valley was all right, sure, but Phoenix was right there on their doorsteps. And there were so many people with so little to lose out there. People who were already killing and raping each other. What would they do once the cops were all too busy struggling for their own survival to defend the stolid burghers of Paradise Valley? Wait too long, and it might be Mad Max time, fighting his way through God knew how many bad guys to get out to the hills. What if they followed him? He could get the fort buttoned up, even if he was fighting a rearguard action. The fort's defenses were explicitly designed for that. But any of the 30 who showed up would be torn apart by the besieging army before they could get to the fort's door. Or worse, they'd make it to the door, but it would be too dangerous to let them in. That would be a real confidence booster when it came to his leadership. Watching helplessly from inside the fort while the chuds and zombies ripped a work colleague to shreds on the doorstep? It was a hard problem. It was never far from Martin's mind as he sat at his Bloomberg terminal and watched the markets move, the currencies rise and fall, the assets bubble up and tank. Martin knew that the event was coming. The fact was the world just didn't need all those people anymore. And the market had revealed that fact, squeezing them into tinier, more uncomfortable places. He wouldn't tolerate it if he was in their shoes. He'd be the first one to build a guillotine. And because he was Martin, it would be an awesome guillotine. So absolutely badass and over-engineered, with a turbocharger and a self-sharpening blade. Because that was Martin all the way. It's why Fort Doom was the incredible place it was. It was all about information asymmetries. Markets corrected them. If knowing a secret could make a stupid, unworthy person rich, then sooner or later, smart, superior people would find that secret out and clear out the misallocated wealth of all those dim bulbs. Markets were awesome at this. Back when everyone lived in shithole mud street villages, the superior people had no choice but to breed with whoever was in the vicinity. Even a 1 in 10 million Six Sigma genius would end up hitched for life to some cow-eyed milkmaid, diluting the incredible genes he'd been handed by nature's Powerball lotto. But little by little, humans got smarter, as the geniuses found smarter milkmaids, until they could build markets, and then the information systems that markets thrived on, and then the information asymmetry started to collapse, slowly at first, then all at once, like a cliff that had been undermined by the inexorable tide of millions of human actions harnessed to the common goal of improving the species and its dominion over the earth. Once the information about where the best people were hanging out became public knowledge, then anyone who fluked into good genes and a high sigma knew exactly where they belonged. Little by little, the world's cities filled up with powerful, self-governing people whose discipline, hard work, and brilliance meant that they got richer and richer. Give the socialists credit. They had this figured out. They knew that the world was heading to a state where the number of betas and gammas the alphas needed to keep the systems running would far exceed the demand, and that those unnecessary people would be squeezed out little by little, and then all at once. They wouldn't go without a fight, of course. Of course, who would? It was just like gentrifying, but on a grand scale. Fuzzy-headed crybaby lefties thought that gentrifying was some kind of conspiracy to screw poor people, but it was just the market again. Location is an asset. If you happened to luck into a house that was a short drive from someplace really important, a financial center, say, or a beautiful view, and all you did with that location was build a shitty little house you couldn't afford to maintain on that plot of land, then the market would solve the problem, and it would hook you up with someone smarter and better than you with the capital to pay you more for the house than you thought it was worth, and then they'd do something with it that made it worth even more. Lots more. That's what markets did. They moved fallow, underutilized assets out of the hands of the incompetent and moved them into the hands of their betters, who put those assets to work. Like a monopoly player who couldn't figure out how to corner suited properties and build houses and hotels, the semi-employed, semi-employable dimbulbs who lucked into a prime piece of location would soon find themselves gently ushered to a place that was better matched with their worth to society and the human race. Lather, rinse, repeat. The smartest and best had figured out how to improve even the most marginal assets, well beyond the capacity of the 99%, and now the 99% had found themselves relieved of all their worldly goods and lacking the sums to rent anywhere to perch while they waited to die. This was an adjustment period. Two words that sounded bloodless and bureaucratic, but which described the chaos that would reign while the unnecessariat was eased out of existence and humanity realigned itself around the strongest and brightest that evolution could select. Martin wasn't a racist. Any couple could win the genetic lottery, and that's why there were a couple of black guys and all those Indian women working at the fund with him, smart as hell. But at the same time, he couldn't help but notice just how many of the smartest people he knew had the same color skin as him. People like Martin called it the event. Economists called it an adjustment period, but people like Martin called it the event. Martin had wrestled with numbers and personalities before settling on the 30. First, why 30? The fort had been built with 15 bedrooms, and he'd done the math on per-person food, water, and other consumable reserves, and every person you added multiplied all those numbers, adding linear feet of shelving to hold toilet paper and MREs and bottled water. Each one translated into more solar panels, more batteries, more gas for the Jennies. But each one was also another strong set of hands to carry and build and fight. Half of them would be women, half of them would be men, half single, half coupled. Martin was single, and he had obviously kept that thought in mind when he picked the single women to invite. He'd made it clear to all the singles that there would be no plus ones on the day. This was an invitation for them and them alone. If their circumstances changed, if they got into a serious thing with someone, then they could tell Martin and he'd pick someone to replace them. It wasn't like they were paying. One of the decisions Martin made early on is that this would all be on his dime. It was a baller move, an alpha move, the kind of thing that would give him leadership credibility when it mattered. And there was a pretty good chance that cash would be worthless after the event. He'd built a hidden vault into Fort Doom with some gold ingots, some encrypted thumb drives with BTC, some dollars, some sapphires, and a few neat packets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.